Thanks to Bob Sham and the collaborator for the invitation and for arranging this very fine conference here. Hong Kong is a very exotic place for us, located in Scandinavia, and I've never been before. So I shall speak a little about a project or a topic which has been covered already twice during this conference, namely the cosmic reason. What is it and what does it mean from a fundamental point of view? It has been covered already by Francesco Intravaia and by Carsten Henkel. So what I shall do is to elucidate, hopefully, some aspects of it from another point of view than perhaps was the case. So I shall then reproduce or speak about this review article here, which is in the journal Symmetry, and is now appearing, I think, the next week probably. So with a somewhat different title. So that is very simple mathematically. It does not contain very many formulas, but I think that its usefulness can be primarily that it contains many references, about 90, so that people interested in this kind of physics can consult it there. So the situation is a standard one, that one of the blocks here is at rest, the other block is at a uniform velocity here, is moving at uniform velocity. And already from a very elementary point of view, one sees something which is characteristic, namely that the force on such a surface here is equal to minus a half times the E squared times the gradient of the permittivity, which is a force which is a normal to the surface. And the force does not do any work on the surface, the coordinate system in which the surface is at rest. Therefore, by a relativistic transformation, it is impossible for that force to have any longitudinal component in another system in which the medium is flowing. So that standard electrodynamics of continuous media is enabled to deal with Casimir friction when the epsilon is a real function. And when I go back to the construction of the stress tensor in phenomenological electrodynamics, it was constructed as a sum of what is actual for the electrostatic case and what is actual for the magnetostatic case. So one simply sums those two and completes with what takes place for the energy and momentum flow and the energy density, and combines and into an energy momentum four-dimensional tensor. And the normal choice for optical cases in accordance with all experiments as far as I know is the Minkowski energy momentum tensor, which is divergence free in ordinary electrodynamics. That means that the components of the total momentum and the total energy make up a four vector. In this case, this is not true because we have a system which is electrodynamically non-closed, so that the total energy and total momentum do not make up a four vector, and we have a system which is basically non-closed. So that already on this very elementary level, we see that we are outside of the region of usual electrodynamics, so that we have to do with a system which is in contact with the thermal reservoir in some sense. All the time we are working outside thermal equilibrium on the same level as we do when we are working in hydrodynamics in the fluid in which we endow to the fluid properties such as shear viscosity and bulk viscosity. That means that one is representing the deviation from thermal equilibrium as a sum over linear of the graded components of the velocity and subtract off what is compatible with the state of uniform motion. There, that brings one to the concept of shear velocity, and the bulk viscosity occurs when you have isotropic condition, for instance, as one has in cosmology and in more complicated circumstances. There is all. Go to this. It works. So, now to look at this from another point of view, which is familiar for everybody here, one can look at this formula here for the electric field, which is then to be written as a sum over them. What is called the generalized susceptibility by Landau and Lipschitz, but which is now nothing else than the retarded grain function. And I can go directly then to this final line here, the actual dissipation theorem. And only one aspect to be emphasized here, it is the imaginary part of the D. So that if you have a retarded grain function, which is completely real, the two-point function is equal to zero. The two-point function equal to zero would be low stress. So that in order to get a stress, we have to invoke in some way a sink, some dissipation, even in vacuum. As you know, in order to fix the integration contour, one has to introduce at least artificially some kind of absorption in order to get this thing to be well defined. So that what is lurking behind all the time here is the contact between electromagnetism of media and the turbine reservoir. That is an overview, a very simple overview of the different aspects of the cadmium phosphate as well now for everybody here, I think. If one considers process which is irreversible, one has to face this problem of the reversible mechanics, how that leads to reversible mechanics, how that leads to a theory of a system which is approaching thermal equilibrium via this Stoffzahl ansatz in the Boltzmann equation. So here is again this standard situation. Here the upper plate is in motion, and one can represent this epsilon for the non-magnetic medium as 1 plus I times the conductivity. This is only then summary of what is contained in the article of Hendry from 1997, that the force, the pressure, or the force per unit area in the tangential direction can be written as in two different forms. The most interesting one for us is this form here, which contains the power of 3 for these velocities here. And when the distance between, or when the velocity is about 1 meter per second, and the separation some nanometer, I think the borderline is about 10 meter per second. And here is an example. If you have a distance d of 1 nanometer value and the sigma for a superconductor like this, the typical force for friction is 1.6 megapascal, the same as you have as a normal component, but you have a separation, as you know, about 1 micrometer. So that is for the semiconductor, and for gold, the force becomes very small. So that it is 10^-21. So this process can be looked upon from several different angles of view. It includes a Doppler effect in some way. And it is possible to look at this from an optical point of view as a Doppler problem. And one can then think about the role of the anomalous Doppler effect. I shall say something about that, even though it is a digression, namely that we have an unusual Doppler effect taking place under some circumstances. And what I shall do here, only to summarize very briefly what we did with Kolbe's test some years ago. It was based upon this Ginzburg and Frohlov theory from 1996. It is of some interest, this theory here. One can look at one detector of the De Witt type. That is a two-level detector which is moving with some constant velocity inside a dielectric isotropic homogeneous medium. And then you have this energy difference between the final state and the initial state, which can be positive or negative, dependent on whether we have an excitation or a de-excitation. And the interaction Lagrangian for such a system is a beta. That is not the inverse temperature, but it is a coupling parameter here. Times a monopole operator, times the scalar field, which is a substitute for the electric field. And one considers it, this in the limit of the first, in the limit of velocities which are less than c. So that if one considers then the seven-luminal velocity case, one can have emission of photons, which are then connected only with the de-excitation of the emitter. So that there is a relation between this emission eigen theta I and the frequency, and this is characterized by the arrow, which is directed down. So that is a usual thing. That
So I think you skipped the slide.
Yes, I said. Mm-hmm.
Go back.
Go back, yeah. Yes. So that if one constructs the amplitude for going from an initial to a final configuration, one can use the normal electrodynamic methods to see what is the transition probability for this kind of thing, and one can then from that find what is the probability per unit time. We have this x equal to v times t, or gamma times v times tau, and then one finds that for a emitter which is moving subluminally, we can have emission of photons in all directions. Whereas, if one goes to the superluminal case, and that is the case which I wish to emphasize here, then we have the possibility of excitation of the detector together with an emission of a photon. And that emission can take place inside the Cherenkov cone, or it can take place outside the Cherenkov cone. So that the emission of a photon together with an excitation of the detector can take place then within the Cherenkov cone. What is this from an electrodynamic point of view? Is that something which is related to the fact that the four vector or the electromagnetic field, according to the Minkowski alternative, is a space-like thing? So that a four vector, which is space-like, admits inertial systems in which the energy is negative. Is that a very characteristic, unusual property of such a vector? And that is the thing which materializes itself in the case of a superluminal motion. So it is a quite nice correspondence between the fundamental the properties of this energy momentum tensor and what we see in the Cherenkov effect. For instance, if one considers the Cherenkov radiation in the coordinate system where the emitter is at rest, the photon gets a negative energy when it is submitted within the Cherenkov cone, and the electron gets a record with a positive energy, so that it shows then the existence of this four vector or the space-like four vector. Well, back to the friction problem. One can look at this from several points of view. What we have been doing in our group at Trondheim is to use the statistical mechanics as a basic method. That is not very much known, I think, in the statistical or in the academic community. But it was developed by my collaborator in Trondheim, Johan Høie, together with George Stell in the United States in many years, and we learned it from Høie, and I think it is a very powerful method, which leads one to the answer quickly, and it is a very robust method. So I think it is a fine method, and that is one alternative listed here. Another one is this use of the quantum field theory methods, which is more in use by Levitov, the first one perhaps, and Bolekin and Pearson. This article of them from 2007 is very readable, very fine. And we have Delkov and Kiasov, and we have other people listed here. And one can use quantum mechanical perturbation theory also, that was done by Barton especially, and by Pendry also, and we also did some work with that in Trondheim. So that if one looks at the interaction between an atom and a plate, one gets from this article of ours from Høie and Milton and myself, this expression here, it is proportional, the force is proportional to v to the third and divided by the distance between particle and plate to the power of 10. So that is in agreement with the result of Intravaya, Behunin and Dalvik from 2014. So it's really nice to find this approximate agreement, because the different predictions in the past have been very wild. So what factor of 3 over 8 is very little compared with 1 million or more, also the case. So from a physical point of view, the friction can be looked upon then as partly due to the fact that one is dragging the image of the atom when one is moving. Yeah, and a related thing is the Einstein-Hopf problem, which is a friction force which is experienced by a particle which is moving with constant velocity in a gas. That is a characteristic behavior which makes it similar to what is the case for for Stokes resistance formula. The force is proportional to the velocity v is input. And that the Stokes law, as you know, is very much made use of in chemistry and in medical science also, whenever there are particles moving very slow. So if one then returns to the Casimirian or friction thing, one sees that if you have a rubidium atom above a silicon surface, the force is small, it is 10 to the minus 20 or 1 newton, so it is extremely small, hardly accessible to experimental measurement at all. And we have also then compared with the usual Casimir folder force between an atom at rest and the surface, that is 10 to the minus 14. So if one looks at the friction between parallel surfaces, one can reproduce this polarizability for a particle with this quantity here. It can be shown theoretically, and we get then a force for unit area. This is Høyland-Breivik. We had worked with this for about 20 years. So that we get a force which is then proportional to the V to the third and divided by D to the C. And I think that I should emphasize this point here. What we get out, in fact, is precisely the same as Barton gets via his approach, which is very different from what we have been following. Barton is using a quantum mechanical perturbation theory, and we did not think that should be in agreement at all. But actually, after some work, we found out that there is agreement, except from a very small factor, which has to do with our neglect of multiple reflections. And if one goes back to Wolle-Keaton and Pearson's article from 2007, we get twice their result. I think that is due to the fact that they are considering all the emission of photon in the forward direction and not in the backward one. I think it is the Freeberg explanation for this. And this factor 12 is different from Pendry, as far as we can see, as we think that Pendry simply has made a calculation error. So I think this line here is the most important line in my presentation at all here. The development from various very, very, very different approaches, the development is converging towards common formula. So that's a very wild different predictions in the past. They are now solved practically. So if one looks at the at final temperature, one gets a fraction between the force at the final temperature and the T equal to zero force, which is given by this formula. It can be looked upon from a physical point of view as a fraction between two characteristic energies, one energy being the thermal energy, and the other energy being not the kinetic energy of the particle, but the V divided by the D. So that the V over D is the central parameter, which is compared with T. So that one sees that at room temperature, here the diffraction Ft over Ft equal to zero is 10 to the 10th. This is quite much. So there, it might be perhaps a possibility then to emit this thing after all. I think the thing is very open. It is not clear cut at all what can be measured. Probably it will not be possible to measure it, but one does not know that for sure. Yeah, here is something about this method with quantum statistical mechanics which we have been using. So this what one does is to make use of the Kuiper formula. As I said, we are working to the first order in the deviation from thermodynamical equilibrium, which is physically the same as using an affliction coefficient in hydrodynamics. And if one then looks at the Hamiltonia, if a vector term by this expression here, in which the psi is the dipolar potential, and this x1 and x2 are characteristics for the two harmonic oscillators. So that one can expand around an arbitrary point here, psi, and then get this instantaneous or the B written formula in this way here. And then this cube formula, which is given here, namely that the terminal expectation value of this force is then given as a commutator times the velocity essentially, so that this phi here is a commutator. It is a commutator between the present value of the Hamiltonian and the past value, the exact value of the frictional force which we are interested to evaluate, the trace of that or the commutator which is inserted there. So that this is a very powerful formula which leads them to the result, so that one can then calculate the force on which is acting, one has to take out the force which is not the friction force, because it is not dependent on the direction of the velocity. So that one can calculate, yeah, here is some more mathematics, I don't think it is so important to go into detail here, the formula is not so difficult to set up, and one gets a force expression which is hopefully to be shown there, so that the force in Fourier space on this particle moving force is then equal to this expression here. So that quantum mechanics is included this formalism here, and otherwise we see that the gradient of the psi occurs two times here. So this is then in agreement with the formula of Barton, and I think that it is a quite effective way to deal with this friction. I think it is in many ways more effective than to deal with field theory. So I have not written up a list of conclusions, but I think that to emphasize that this system has from an electrodynamic point of view to be looked upon as a system which is non-closed, that is an important thing. And moreover, I should recommend people to be somewhat acquainted with quantum statistical methods, because yes, it is very effective. There are many more slides in this PDF file here, so that the people who are interested to read about that thing can read it down there. But I don't think I should say more here now. Yeah.
So the talk is open to questions, if you have something to ask. We thought you might have some
linear extrapolation.
By default.
Yeah, give him a microphone, he will formulate a question.
Okay, so if you don't have any questions, let's start to speak around the time. The last talk is by Efe Sanon. Am I saying correct your last name?
Yes, sir.